Okay, folks, we're going to get started. Thank you for joining me today at the StarWest conference in the Disneyland Hotel. And thanks to all who are joining us on the virtual session. I really appreciate you spending your time with me. I'm going to give a little bit of background to myself before we get going. My name is Al Wagner. I'm a testing evangelist with IBM. I've been with IBM for 14 years in a number of roles and played in the IT world for the last 20 years. Been a configuration administrator, been a performance tester, a functional tester, a developer, support, enablement, instructor, mentor, just a variety of roles, all with the purpose of trying to help accelerate delivery of software, deliver better quality software to market, and help testers solve the problems that they face on a daily basis. And that's really what we're going to talk about today, trying to help the testers solve their problems to deliver a higher quality software to the end user. So if we look back a little while, and not that long ago, honestly, organizations looked to balance quality and speed. And they tried to do this by minimizing risk. But what typically happens is as we move across the time axis, you know, we did late stage testing. Perhaps we were doing manual testing. We didn't have the environments that we needed, which pushed us across that time. And as the longer we waited, the cost increased, as did the risk to us to get a spot in the market where we were either establishing a new market or being a leader in the market. So it's really a question of time. We're trying to do more in less time and test to a higher level of efficiency so that we get better software out. Because at the end of the day, it is the end user that is the final tester. They will determine who wins in the market. Whether it's internally, everybody is your customer. Whether it's an internal deployment, if the end users aren't getting success or satisfaction from the product that you've given them, they're not happy. They're not maybe going to use the software, they're going to push back. Externally, it's revenue to an organization, and that's everything. So, you know, again, looking back, we took too long to get to market. It cost too much money to get to market. And by the time we got there, perhaps we didn't have the market share. Now, if we fast forward a little bit, it really hasn't changed a whole bunch. You know, greater than 70% of budgets are still dedicated to maintenance and operations costs. 4 to 6 weeks to deliver even the minor change. You know, customers are experiencing production delays in getting those bug fixes out or getting that fix pack or that new version of the code that was promised to them. And, you know, some of these outsourced projects are failing to meet expectations. It's all about the system of interaction, system of record, and getting everything to work together more efficiently so we can get that software out quicker. And that's really the story we're going to talk about today, is accelerating that delivery. But we want to deliver high-quality software. Anybody can put really bad software out quickly, but you're not going to win in the market. You're not going to get the user experience that you're hoping for. You're not going to get the customer satisfaction. So this is what I'm talking about. We're shifting to the left. We're going to start doing more testing earlier. We're going to do better testing earlier. We're going to lower the cost of testing so we can get this release the software to market much sooner so we can either establish the market or be the leader in the market. And notice how the green curve has pulled in towards the center axis. We really want to catch the defects much sooner in the process so that we can resolve them. So we're moving from a world of late stage defect identification to a world of early stage defect identification. And as we get closer to release, we're into validation. We're finding that the software is working as expected instead of logging bugs because it's not working as expected. And again, it's the end user decides. So the organization that can get their software out to market fast, it delivers on what the customer is expecting, delivers a high quality product, and is doing it faster than everybody else, better, cheaper, faster is going to win. So then, how do we do this? And you've been at the conference or you've been following various thought leaders in the social world, this DevOps. What is DevOps all about? And I'll talk a little bit more about where testing fits in the DevOps world, but DevOps is about, in the simplest form, extending agile and lean across the entire delivery lifecycle, software delivery lifecycle, from ideation to implementation. from the thought of how am I going to steer, how am I going to plan, how am I going to drive this into my develop and test, how am I going to build this, how am I going to collaborate across my team, how am I going to remove the bottlenecks, remove the silos, work as a single community, all working with the end goal of delivering quality to the end user. How are we going to test this? How are we going to deploy this across our environments quickly, continuously, as part of our continuous integration process? How are we going to take that build and move it across the various QA stages all the way out into production efficiently and repeatably and reliably? And then once we have it into production, how are we going to monitor it? How are we going to optimize it? How are we going to make sure that the end user experience is positive, is as best as it can be? And if it starts to slow down or we start to notice things, how are we going to fix that or address that? And the whole time we're going through this cycle, we're getting continuous feedback. As we're continuous delivering innovation, we're getting continuous feedback and making the course corrections that are needed to achieve our goal of the organization of accelerating software delivery, getting faster time to value, balancing the speed, cost, quality, and risk, and reducing time to that customer feedback. Everybody in this cycle should be contributing to a positive customer experience, positive end user experience. So what the IBM DevOps approach is an enterprise capability to do that. But DevOps, DevOps, DevOps. I've seen in the social blogs and other areas, testers, where do testers fit in DevOps? If you look at that life cycle, that continuous delivery pipeline from development to production, at least a third of it is testing. With all those stages you have to go through, and once you've got that build, you're going to do a subset of testing. We really don't want to have this silo throw it over the fence. We want to be part of that process. So we look at the business owner, you know, the steer side. We've got development, testing, deploy, production to the customer. A major component of that whole process is testing. And it's about time. So how do we make testing more efficient? How do we do things faster? How do we make that only one-third of the continuous delivery pipeline instead of probably 50 or 60% that it may actually be? How do we get the test environments we need? How do we deal with things when we don't have the software that we need? How do we deal with access to third-party services that are available from a service provider that may not be available to us when we need them? We need to be able to test what we want, how we want, when we want. So everything between development, the creation of the software put into a build package to release into production is testing. So what am I going to talk about to solve this problem and do this testing more efficiently? Well, we'll talk a little bit about how we're going to manage quality across the lifecycle. We'll focus a lot on solving the test environment dilemma. Then we'll deal into where do we feel or where do I feel you should prioritize or focus your attention on for test automation. Then how do we orchestrate it? How do we automate it? How do we take that build and get it from the build server out to the production environment and do it without having to touch, make changes and all this stuff along the way? Because every time we make a change to a configuration file or rewire something or introduce new code, we're introducing opportunity for a defect. We want to remove that opportunity to inject new defects. We want to push things through automation. So earlier this year, again, I said earlier initially that I was focused on helping testers test. And to do that, I had to understand your problems. And I partnered with TechWell, the team from SQE. I partnered with UTest, now known as Applause. And I partnered with Keynote. And we published a survey. So there's the short URL to access this survey. There's a QR code for those online to access it quickly. In that survey, I asked 25 questions. Basically, I wanted to find out what were your problems, where were you spending your time that you thought it was not good use of your time, and where did you want to spend your time? And that survey, the data that we have in that survey, highlights all of these things. But I wanted to point out a couple of stats that we got out of this. One is this. I asked one question. If you could make one organizational change in your organization, what would that be? The number one answer was increase automated testing. Now, I know there's a debate as to, you know, whether to automate or not, but this is feedback straight from 250 testers from around the world, 6 to 10 years experience, and their roles were primarily test managers, test leads, or quality managers. Number two, involve the testers earlier. Break down this silo. Break down this developer creates a build, throws it over to the fence. Developers have to figure out how this thing works and validate that it works as expected. Promote the value of the tester. What I heard there was, you know, elevate the status of the tester. Make the tester a first-class citizen. They're equally as important, if not, you know, to the development role. How do we do that? The second last one, improve requirements. How do you improve requirements? You get testers involved earlier. You get them to ask questions. Why? How come? And then last one, hire more testers. Well, I could ask that to any demographic in any organization, and they're going to say, hire more of me. So I had to discount that one. But, you know, download these results. The other thing as we go through, I want you to keep two figures or two other bits of data in your mind. We asked a question of 15 different types of activities. Where would you like to spend more time? The number one space was test automation, creating automated test scripts. The number two was more test planning. Number three was better test case design or better test design. All improvements to better quality, getting software out faster, being involved earlier, all tied to this. Where were the two main areas they wanted to spend less time? Standing up test environments, dealing with test data. So that's the second item we're going to talk about. The one item that I found really quite interesting was we asked the question, how confident are you in the quality of the software you're releasing? And this one was a little frightening. So confident can be taken a number of ways, but I was looking at it, are you feel good about how you've tested this product and will it deliver on the requirements that you were testing against? And will your user have a good experience with this and will you win with this product? 41% of the testers said they had little to no confidence in the quality of the software being released. So there's obviously opportunity for improvement. How do we fix it? How do we get testers to spend more time where they want to test and less time in the areas that they feel their time is of little value? So quality across the lifecycle, getting the testers involved earlier. You can't test quality in. Everybody's heard that before. You have to build it in from the start. Now, tools that people use primarily, yeah, there were some vendor solutions, were docs and spreadsheets. Extremely inefficient. When we're dealing with time, you know, the manual update of execution results, the review, the creation, the linkage, the tracing, the triage, it's just a terribly inefficient process. So look at a quality management solution that delivers you the opportunity to not only look into the requirements, have better traceability from your test effort, your plans, your designs to these requirements to make sure that you've got the coverage that you need. Look to the other side. What defects are perhaps blocking you from running the test case? What defects are associated to an execution result? Automate that, because one of the other things the tester said they didn't like to do was reports. Well, if you're using Word and Excel, you're going to be manually creating reports. Either you're writing macros or something. Look at a quality management solution like Rational Quality Manager that gives you the test planning, the construction, the execution, and the reporting capability. But more importantly, the collaboration across the entire team. Have that visibility into the requirements. Have that visibility into the development work items. Have that visibility into the defects, or link those defects to the work items, because it's the developers who write the code, they write the bugs, they fix the bugs. You might as well link the bug to their change request or their change management record. And then off of that quality management, you've got to drive execution, an automated execution. You're not going to automate everything. Automation isn't a silver bullet that's going to fix all your problems. But you want to at least have that linkage for the reporting purposes, that traceability and the ability to drive automation. Now from that, because of your reporting and your dashboards, those weekly status meetings that, you know, you're spending an hour with your leads or your management or whatever, and here's the report, boss, let them have a dashboard. Give them access through a thin client and let them see, you know, these are the number of test cases executed. It's our job to share that information back, but it's the stakeholder's job to process that information and determine whether you're going to release or not. They're making that final decision because they're looking at it from the needs of the business. How much is the business invested in a campaign to release new software? They're not going to delay it. They want to make sure that you're efficient in your delivery, that you can fix that defect if it gets into production and fix it quickly before the customer finds it. Again, they're looking at managing risk, and they want to be able to release with confidence, having made informed decisions. So, you know, leverage a solution to help you with your quality management. So the next one I wanted to talk about was the test environment dilemma. These environments aren't getting any easier to stand up. With SaaS and integration into legacy components within your enterprise, or merging with companies, or partnering with other businesses, you've got a crazy amount of technology as part of your application, and if you're going to test end to end, you need to stand that up somehow. And I don't know, but not everybody has, you know, 15 mainframe environments sitting standby for a test environment if you need it, or multiple SAP implementations, or, you know, endless amounts of servers just sitting there idle. So test labs are typically underutilized. They're very expensive to stand up, particularly when you consider the complexity of the applications that are built today. And these are causing delays, a big bottleneck in this delivery pipeline. You know, if there's some stats at the bottom here, $5 to $30 million is the typical investment in a single test lab for a Fortune 500 company. 30 to 50% of the time is the average amount of time testers spend standing these environments up. That was substantiated in the survey as well. What are people doing to solve, or how much time are they spending with these test environments? How are they solving these problems? So there's a couple of other little facts that I'm going to tap in off of that particular stat. 50% of my day, of my week, sorry, is, let's use a 40-hour work week. Nobody works that, but let's just use 40 because it's easy. So 30 to 50%. 2.5 days of a 5-day work week spent on test labs. Emails, ad hoc meetings, fire drills, what else you got? You know, another day and a half a week, day a week. How much time are you really testing? We heard anywhere from, you know, the majority of people were 1 or 2 days a week were lost to non-testing type days. But there was a substantial number of people that 4 or 5 days were lost to this other stuff. So we have to solve this. We have to find the time. We have to get this time back so we're actually testing. So how do we do it? Well, test environments, you know, these are the four main things I'm going to talk about here. In the survey, people talked a lot about test data management really consuming their time, building it from scratch, cloning production and then manually editing, making private data secure because they have, you know, to be compliant with certain regulatory bodies. So test data management, big time consuming amount of effort. Service virtualization. You might hear it as stubs, mocks, stand-ins, but basically we're talking about virtual components to simulate the functionality and behavior of components. These may be the components that you have in one area that you're going to record and create a virtual stub to stand in, but you can replicate it across and create multiple test environments at a fraction of the cost. Another example of a third-party service is, for service virtualization, third-party service. Every time you're going to touch that service as part of your testing, it costs you maybe a penny, half a penny. Doesn't sound like a lot. Touch that service for 8 hours with 5,000 concurrent users at 300 transactions per second in a performance test and see how fast those pennies add up. Use a stub, a mock, a virtual component through service virtualization to stand in and simulate that third-party service. Now, that's all fine and good. You know, we got, so yeah, I can help you with your test data. We can simulate functionality, but we got to deploy it. And we got to push it across multiple stages because we're going to go from a development world to QA1 to QA2 to QA3 to UAT, pre-production, and then out into production. That's a lot of effort, particularly if we're waiting for somebody in ops or somebody in your own team to come available that's technically skilled enough or has that experience that can do this repeatedly and knows which files to change and knows how to get this across these stages quickly. And then we need dynamic infrastructure. Not everybody's got a whole bunch of servers standing around, so you look at clouds. You know, leverage the clouds. So, test data. Something like Optum Test Data Management from the IBM InfoSphere brand. Information management brand, sorry. Reduce cost. So you take these production databases, you extract right-sized data, bring out the amount of data you need, filter out the types of records you need from your production environment. Reduce the risk. Use the capabilities within the product to mask the sensitive data. Hide the identity, hide the personal information so that you can use it in a test world. And then on a refresh, how much time do you spend rolling back your test databases or waiting for your DBA to roll something back? Automate it. And this can all be done through a web interface. This and also this refresh can also be done through the deployment automation solution that I'll talk to shortly. But better, cheaper, faster. Reduce the size of the databases that we're going to pull out of production. Just pull out what you need. Mask it so you can protect personal information. And then refresh it on demand so that you can quickly reset your test environment from a test data point of view. Next is rational test virtualization server. You know, with our products, support for simulating web services, databases, WebSphere, MQ, WebSphere App Server, mainframes, IMS kicks. You got dependencies on those. They can be simulated, so you don't need to wait for access to the mainframe or buy multiple mainframes. SAP is a new one that just came out in our latest version. But what we're trying to do is to test an application end-to-end, you need a completed test environment. You need a realistic, production-like, complete test environment with all the pieces. Whether it's a mix of the real deployments and virtual services, or you're fortunate enough to have all the components that you can test, to truly validate your application end-to-end and do it continuously, you need a realistic environment. So like I said earlier, with virtual services, combined with the code that you would already have, and the infrastructure that you can either use dynamic infrastructure or have the physical infrastructure in place, gives you the ability to test what you want, when you want, how you want, but at a much lower cost because you can use virtual services to stand in, simulating that functionality that would be otherwise unavailable. Now we took the test data management issue, we have IBM InfoSphere Optum, we have a rational test virtualization server to give you the service virtualization functionality. Now we're looking at IBM Urban Code Deploy. This is the piece that Urban Code does it in a very unique way. They break down the deployment model into four areas. The environments, nodes, components, and then the code. So we're looking at what we're able to do here is take a build using deploy, and maybe we're going to put it into QA1. And QA1 has one node, one server, and on that server we're going to have the app layer, the web server layer, and the database layer. So we've got those components, those We're going to put those across the environments. We go to QA2. Now we have two nodes. In that one, we're going to put the web server and the app server on node 1, and we're going to put the database server on node 2. It's all done through a process designer. We're not changing configurations. This is all managed through the Urban Code Deploy process designer. And now we can deploy this across QA1. We can also implement quality gates. So I build, my unit test runs, Urban Code Deploy pushes that build out across my environment. Urban Code Deploy can talk to test virtualization server and turn on the stubs or the virtual components it may need. It can run the tests, and if those tests pass, a quality gate will allow you to move it into quality QA2 automatically. Now, this gives you the ability to automate the deployment consistently and repeatedly, and if those quality gates are missed, you roll it back. You can do this across multiple servers, tiers, and components, and manage the middleware and provisioning of the service virtualization pieces. Now we've got to orchestrate all of this. So we've got our test data management, we've got our service virtualization, we've got our deployment automation, but we need that dynamic infrastructure. And here's where the Urban Code Deploy with patterns comes in. Through a pattern designer, I can take all of those pieces and move it across and stand up multiple test environments very, very quickly. So now we've got our stuff going across our test environments quickly. But the next thing I wanted to talk about was test automation. Where do you want to focus your test automation activities? If we're looking at testing through the UI, whether it be manual or an automated record and playback tool, typically you're waiting for that user interface to stabilize, be developed, contain the components that you need to execute the new functionality. We're really missing a lot of stuff underneath the surface, all these components. Because if I run a test in the UI and an error message comes back, what do I really get out of that error message? Yeah, something failed. So I submit a defect to the developer. What is the developer going to do? Because I was one. You got to go into logs. You got to start walking through your code and figure out, okay, where did that defect actually be realized? Where was it realized? Well, it was probably an exchange of something within a component or between two components or within a component itself. So we want to push testing down. We want to do more testing at the unit level, and we want to do more testing at the integration level, validating the messages exchanged between the individual components, because that will allow us to isolate the defects faster. And if we're doing this continuously, this continuous integration testing, and we're getting these defects to come out of the system quickly, and we've isolated to a component, wouldn't a developer be more receptive to information where you've said, oh, by the way, component A talking to component B, it's not working. You've given them so much more information to help them solve the problems, as opposed to, oh, by the way, I got this error message on screen XYZ. Fix it. I have no idea where, but this is these are the steps that I ran through a user interface. So we want to drive that testing down. We want to focus more on finding those hidden dangers. How do we do that? You've probably seen the testing pyramid from the agile world. So, you know, we're talking about the UI layer above the iceberg, the components down below, that's where the developers are unit testing. That piece in the middle, that services layer, that's kind of a forgotten layer lately. That's where we want to focus our energy. Focus on testing those services. Exercise the messages between components. Now, service virtualization, it's not just for integration testing. A unit test, instead of, you know, simulating or mocking in the JVM or faking out a return or a call to another component, let them exercise it. But primarily, it's going to be used in testing the integrations between components and simulating the missing components so that you can validate those pieces. Now, again, what we're trying to do is, if we push that down and push that into the deployment process, we're testing that earlier. And as this new code is being checked in and the build is being run, imagine the information you're going to get, the feedback you're going to get, when every time a build runs and the build unit test runs, that a BVT runs and these integration tests run, and you use virtual components, you're getting all this data back at a time when the developers, their development environment is still in the same sprint that you're testing. You're testing in sync with development. So many places, you know, they get into the crunch of a sprint, and so we're doing sprint run regression testing, boss. But yeah, but you're doing it in sprint two. The developers have moved on. We want to get to done in that sprint. We want to move with the developers. You know, it's going to be a lot easier to get the developers to help you fix these defects if they don't have to roll back their environment. We're working in partnership. We're getting involved earlier. We're asking better questions. So not only are we driving out better requirements, better designs, because that's what testers do. They ask questions. But we're testing it in sync with the development and giving them that information back very quickly. So you're going to have to do some test automation. So within rational test workbench, single workbench that gives you the ability to do that integration testing, test at that services layer. It also gives you the ability to do performance testing, your traditional performance testing. The user interface testing through the UI, yeah, you're still going to have some of that automation still within this workbench. And there's also the ability to do mobile testing as well, testing the mobile app as well as the web app. So what we're trying to do is offer a solution that covers all of your test automation needs, allows you to test across multiple channels, validate the integrations much earlier in the lifecycle so that you can get that continuous feedback, but create tests that are resilient to change. We don't need a test to break if, you know, in a UI test, we don't need a test to break if you change the button name from yes to okay. Accept that, right? That's a trivial defect as opposed to pressing okay in the laptop, the screen, blue screen's on you. And then, you know, building the stubs of the virtual components through the rational test workbench, because you build them in test workbench, you deploy them to test virtualization servers so you can scale across your enterprise. You know, you have the ability to build out those components so that you can, you know, scale your test environments as well as through performance testing, validate the scalability of your server and your integration infrastructure. What we're trying to do here is on this shift left is take that defect discovery hump of the traditional project lifecycle where, yeah, I get some defects. Oh, okay, I got all the pieces. I can test end to end. Big bang, lots of defects show up, tails off, missed the delivery date, you know, everything's delayed, bosses aren't happy, customers are disappointed, revenue starts to decline. Again, shift all that important testing to the left, do more integration, do more unit, leverage some technologies like service virtualization to give you that ability, and as you move towards the release date, you move from one of defect identification to one of confirmation and validation that things are working as expected. So when we're talking about these virtual components, definitely a place in integration, but as you move towards the user acceptance operability, your dependency on virtual components decreases and you start to leverage more of the real implementations. So here's the big picture all in one slide. For the DevOps approach, extend agile and lean across the delivery lifecycle. Manage quality across the lifecycle with rational quality manager. Be able to stand up production-like test environments really quickly. Rational quality manager has integration into rational test virtualization server, as does urban code deploy, to turn on these virtual components or stand up these test environments in an automated manner. Comprehensive test automation, integration, functional performance, mobile. One workbench to cover multiple platforms, to give you validation across all channels and unintended execution, then you need the orchestration. So the urban code with urban code deploy with patterns, replicate this, make this repeatable across multiple environments. Now, if we took that pyramid and we looked back at this delivery lifecycle and flipped it, through the left, development focuses on more unit testing. The survey said 40% of people aren't doing automated unit testing. I would expect that number to be lower. It should be lower. It should be much lower because it is the developers who are writing the bugs. Let's let them do the first round of testing and find them. On the testing stages, continuous integration testing of the services at the API layer, validating the messages exchanged between the components. As we move out to the staging, we're going to have some UI tests along the way, but as we move further out, do more exploratory, more user interface testing, user acceptance testing, and then we're ready to go into production. But the main message, from ideation to implementation, everybody's contributing to quality. Everybody's mission is to deliver a positive user experience, and through positive user experience, you contribute to the success of the business. So, let's take these challenges and turn them into opportunities. Lack of environments, poor utilization, repeatedly accurately deploy the test environments, urban code with patterns. Incomplete labs, you're missing software, you don't have access to a third-party system, it's too expensive to stand up a mainframe, you don't have the skills to replicate multiple SAP environments. Test virtualization server. Virtualize what you don't have and do it at a much lower cost. Test data is taking too long to create, refresh, and manage. Something like IBM InfoSphere Optum Test Data Management. Deploy those right-sized private test databases that you can refresh on demand. Insufficient testing. You know, not enough resources. Testing takes too long. I've heard things, testing takes as long as it takes. Well, if it takes 3 weeks more than your boss is going to deliver or give you to test, you got to figure out how to make it fit that window. So, you know, let's test things earlier. Let's leverage automation where it makes sense. Test these integrations earlier. And defects, you know, defects escape, test coverage. If we do more testing earlier, we get better test coverage. We can release software with a higher level of confidence. Maybe we can drive that number down from 41% of little to no confidence, make that a much lower where the testers have the time to deal with the ad hoc stuff, to deal with some, because we're removing the bottlenecks around the things that they can control. Make test labs available more efficiently. Now, earlier this year, a number of the vendors met with the Gartner analyst crew, and you know, here's a result, just for your reference, if you want to check, you can access it on the IBM.com site. And with that, I have a few minutes left. Beth, is there any questions from the community or any questions on the floor? Just raise your hands. Oh, okay, there. Okay, so the question was, from the test automation perspective, what was the tool I was mentioning? It's called Rational Test Workbench. Inside that tool, you have the ability to do automated integration testing, test at the API layer, the ability to do functional testing, like our Rational Functional Tester product, performance testing. So there's continuous performance, where you can continuously test the performance between components. That can be done with the Rational Integration Tester piece inside the workbench, or performance testers through the user interface. So Test Workbench is the product name. There's three capabilities: integration, performance, functional, and then there's also the mobile Eclipse client. To do the integration testing, that is really importing the message format and then populating it with data, either as, you know, your input data or your expected result, and validating that. There's really not a lot of programming experience there. That is more knowledge of the test environment when you model it out in the architecture school and understand where all the pieces are deployed. Functional tester, there's a VB.NET version or there's a Java version. There's also simplified scripting, which creates scripts in a very business-like language. I'm a programmer, so I was never afraid by the Java and extension and OO concepts. I could see how some people may be reluctant around the Java side of it, but again, the simplified scripting is there, so it reads very much English-like. Performance tester, you can extend it. You're going to need some development skills. but it does a very good job of correlation. So as you get data coming back from a response that you need to use as the input for the next request, a lot of that is done in the tool automatically for you. So, you know, very quickly, somebody can record and be productive with any one of the tools. Okay.
We do have a question from the virtual audience for you, Al.
Okay.
Does Rational Workbench support hybrid cloud as a software as a service platform?
Does Rational Tech Workbench support hybrid cloud? I would have to give an honest, I'd like to take that one offline and check a little deeper. I don't want to give or mislead information here. And I'm wondering, are they wanting to put the tool in the cloud, so as a remote desktop type of thing, or are they wanting to test cloud applications deployed in the cloud?
I'll see if I can get some clarification.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. But make sure you mark that one, Beth, and I will respond to it. Any more questions from the floor? How's the week been? Has it been good? Lots of education, lots of knowledge being shared, lots of networking. That's the important part of this, these shows. Yes, sir. Okay, so the question is, when is the right time to log issues that you may discover through your testing exercise? Is that a good paraphrase? Okay. To log them, the integrations with these tools are direct into a defect change management system. So when I get a failure in my test execution record, I can look at it and maybe do a quick check of a comparator and say, here's the expected, here's the actual. Is this a, you know, as a tester, oh, wait a minute, I forgot to update this script, so my actual expected results should be what I actually got. So I'm just going to replace that so I can fix my test script very quickly. So that one I wouldn't submit an issue on. Or if you're not the person who does the test scripts, maybe you submit the issue, but you submit it against the test script itself as opposed to the code. But a lot of this information captured in the execution result, I'm assuming when is the right time to log the incident is related to how much time it takes you to put the information into the defect or the incident that you're going to submit, and that's slowing you down on the testing. So look for a tool that will take the information from the execution log and auto-insert it into the defect. So it's a quick thing. It's with our products, I find the defect, the tool has identified a failure in the test, whether that be a code problem or an issue with the test script. You know, it's kind of a right-click action, submit defect. The log information shows up there, how the developer can recreate that situation to replicate that defect. And it's all, you know, set a priority on it, a due date, and submit it. Now, that goes into a report, so when you have your triage, then you can prioritize as to which defects make sense. So it's really not a laborious process to get that information into some kind of a change management solution. Okay, but I would, you know, if you're doing it in it, so I'm gonna wait till Friday till I submit everything. What if you forget some? Right, and it's a Sev 1. It's make that handoff, that process, get that information, because it's all about collaboration. Get that happening sooner. Yes, sir. It is a key piece, and rather than answer that, I'm going to direct you to something. October 22nd, 1 p.m. Eastern Time, with the SQE team, Eric Minnick is the delivery or the deployment evangelist with the Urban Code. Eric knows Urban Code cold. Please register for that webcast. You can pick it up on the TechWell, the SQE webinar site. It's available. Again, October 22nd, 1 p.m. Eastern Time. Eric's the absolute right guy to answer that question, and I'd love to see you on that, and I'll make sure that we get that question asked. OK, Okay, folks, thanks for everybody joining through the web, and thanks for everybody who came into the room and spent this 45 minutes with me. I really appreciated your time, and I hope you got something out of it. We're at the IBM booth 1. We're there till 3. As soon as you come in the door, you can't miss us. If you want to see a demo, more than happy to show you how this stuff works. And there's a number if we've got some mobile capabilities there as well. So again, thank you very, very much for your time.